Great. Okay, good. Well, thanks for having me on. It's a really a pleasure to be back on the Proactive platform to talk to our shareholders and prospective investors tonight. I'm going to take you through the Shanta story, and I want to keep it really simple because it doesn't have to be complicated. What I'm going to share with you tonight is a story about Shanta, the gold producer and explorer in East Africa. And we'll go through those two points. In summary, you can see on this slide here, high quality and expanding portfolio. So we own three assets in two countries. So we have a diversified risk base across these two countries. And we're going to demonstrate tonight that the company is significantly de-risked and has demonstrable upside in the portfolio. And I'll take you through why I believe that and what I think is being missed by the market. You can see here we're a sub $200 million market cap company. We generate real cash flow. We pay a dividend. We don't have any debt, $24 million of cash. We're unhedged. And we've set the company up to where we want it to be able to realize the value from our exploration portfolio. So as I said, we've been around for a long time. We've been operating in East Africa for 20 years. We've been listed on the AIM exchange for 15. And we're well known by a lot of the most important institutional investors in London. Now, what's so exciting about the story? Listen, you've introduced it perfectly well. This West Kenya project that we acquired 12 months ago is really delivering. Now, take a look at this slide here. This is not me who put this together. This is one of the research houses in London called Liberum. And what they've done here is they've benchmarked some of the drilling results that we've been able to deliver this year across the global benchmark of exploration plays. Shanta ranks number two year to date in the world. I think it was actually at the start of August, we announced 4 meters at 706 grams per ton. And some might say that's a fluke, wasn't meant to be. Well, in fact, in May, we announced 6 meters at 220 grams per ton. And you can start to see a bit of a trend here. This asset is incredibly high grade. It's in our neck of the woods in East Africa. It's gold, which we know incredibly well. It's the same type of mining method that we already do in Tanzania. And it happens to be in this address called the Lake Victoria Goldfield, which is where there's been about 40 million ounces produced by some of the best and the brightest assets and geologists around. So the likes of North Mara from Barrick, Bulyanhulu, AngloGold's Geita. This is all in this Lake Victoria Goldfield. And we acquired 1,160 square kilometers and 1.2 million ounces grading 12.6 grams per ton last year. So is that it? Is that where we stop? Is that the whole story about Shanta? Absolutely not. This is a district scale play. And you know, if you have the fortune or the good fortune of spending a few minutes with our head of exploration, he'll tell you it has some of the characteristics of the great greenstone belts around the world where he's worked. We put a few more of these intersections on this slide. Again, you can start to see the pattern, very high grade across these two deposits that are separated by about a kilometer. What are we doing with the project? Well, we started drilling here at the start of the year. This is infill drilling. We're carrying on from the 220,000 meters of drilling that's already happened by the likes of Barrick and others. And the strategy is twofold. One is to upgrade the resource. So it's currently inferred, upgrade it into indicated. So that adds value. And the other is to expand the inferred resource to make it bigger. Question is, can we do it? Well, we'll have a few updates probably in early September to take the investors and the market through that. What are we trying to achieve? Well, we're trying to get to a very high grade, indicated mineable resource, so effectively the likes of a reserve. Try and keep it around that 10 gram per ton mark, but very high grade, and establish a project that can move through the cycle or move through the stages of development. And so as you see here on the next slide, seeing is believing. Now, when we talk about bonanza grades, and when we talk about the West Canada project, we typically talk in terms of visible gold. And so what we're finding is about every third hole that we pull out of this project will have VG in it. And when you talk to a typical geologist, they'll say, well, VG is great because you can see specks of gold. Well, in fact, at the West Kenya project, it doesn't come in specks. The geologists refer to it as constellations. And from our perspective, you can see it here. It's literally, you know, this hole we announced in early August. When they had it coming out of the drill rig in late June, they referred to it as dripping in gold. Very, very, very exciting. And it's catching the likes of other investors and other gold companies who can see the value. Now let's put this in perspective. We paid $14.5 million for this project 12 months ago. That implies $12 an ounce. A similar inferred project will be of much lower quality. We trade at $40 to $50 per ounce. So we have 1.2 million ounces, call it a $50 million valuation. Measured and indicated ounces trade closer to about $150 per ounce. So you can kind of see where I'm headed. What we paid for it at $14.5 million, we think, and certainly the arguments are there, that's worth a lot more. And when you then look at the rest of our portfolio, which we'll go over in a second, compare that to our current market cap, we think there's a lot of value to be demonstrated. Now, one analyst recently called this project Shanta's ace in the hole. It's not well known to the market. It's getting more and more attention, but Kenya is obviously a place where there hasn't been much large scale mining other than a few on the coast. And what we'd like to make the point here is that the West Kenya project will become part of Shanta's equity story more and more going forward. So there's clear for the re-rate potential. What's next at West Kenya? I already said we'll have the resource update out shortly, and we will also be putting out our sixth update of drilling results, probably in early September. It's all coming together really nicely. Now let's turn our attention to the portfolio. Remember, a simple equity story, three assets, two countries. We have this super high grade, incredibly rich, undervalued West Kenya project, which is looking more and more like it's going to be a mine. And then we have these two other assets in Tanzania, one which has been in production for 9 years, called the new Luika Gold Mine. And in fact, there we've just put out a new 5-year mine plan. Combined with that, we also have this other asset in Tanzania called Singida that we're building. And combined, those two assets will take us over 100,000 ounces of production by the end of next year, early 23. So what's in the 5-year mine plan? Well, 500,000 ounces of production over the next 5 years. As I said, it says here on the slide, averaging 116,000 ounces per year. Again, put this in perspective, no debt on the balance sheet, unhedged, cash on hand. So this really just will add to the cash generation and the cash asset we have in hand. It'll enhance our ability to pay more dividends because that's something we're fully committed to. Now, for the second half of this year, we're estimating in our 5-year mine plan that we had published in July, we're estimating about 33,000 ounces. And so we're on track for that. We've done a lot of grade control drilling over the next 0 to 12 to 18 months. And so we have a really good feel for what the geology will look like over the planned producing areas of the new Luika Gold Mine. And we're feeling pretty good about delivering on those plans. Now, why this slide? What does this mean what does it mean to be replacing mined reserves? Take a step back. Exploration for us, for Shanta, has been the single best source of value to date. The bigger picture here is that all of our infrastructure, all of our assets, all the people, all the skills, the track record, the relationships with community, that's all in place. That's established and that's working really well, particularly at New Luika, where we are in production already. So every single ounce that we can add to the mine plan further extends the life without having to invest any more capital. It's kind of like if you have a hotel and you add another night of revenue, you don't have to build any more hotel rooms. You're simply adding more cash flow at the margin. So when we think of it, when we think of discovery costs, for instance, for a reserve ounce would be, say, I don't know, $20-$25 per ounce, and the margin generates $700-$900 per ounce of margin, that is hugely compelling and a great place to be allocating capital. Now, this slide here shows that since 2019, when we started drilling again, when we finally had some breathing space, our head was above water, we weren't struggling with the debt load that we inherited, we added, since 2019, 346,000 ounces of reserves. So basically, for every ounce that we mined, we added 1.25 ounces to the plan. And so what does that mean? It means as we're mining, you know, naturally you're depleting your ounces, but as you're exploring, you're replacing and you're actually extending. So this is a really important concept, particularly for a company like Shanta, where mine life extension is so important because all the assets are already invested. What does that mean? Well, it means we're going to continue to allocate real dollars into exploration because we think we can generate fantastic returns on the back of it. Now, onto our third asset called Singida. This is the construction asset in central Tanzania. This is an open pit project, relatively straightforward, given its mining straight from surface. Where we are with this project is we're aiming to have it into production by the end of next year. It's self-funded, so we're going to pay for it from our existing cash flows at our other Tanzanian project. All the money in country just gets recycled into Singida, so it's quite efficient that way. And in terms of the actual progress report here, we've noted that we have now the mill and crusher on order and in the manufacturing process. The TSF has been designed and is on charging on its way towards approval from the commission. And this quarter, we've now started pre-stripping. So that's what that means is really getting the surface area prepared at the Gold Tree deposit where we're planning to start mining. Not too far away from now. We'll be doing grade control drilling before the end of the year and really getting ready to start the stockpiling in the next few months of ore. So Singida is this third asset in our portfolio, further diversifies the risk, brings new sources of cash flow into the stream of revenues that we'll generate, and most importantly, adds scale. So we'll be now with Singida, we'll be up to over about 110,000 ounces of production per year. So in summary, you know, what is the big story here with Shanta? Well, you know, we're a sub $200 million market cap company. We think that should be, you know, much closer to $500 million, to be honest. When you look at the likes of the West Kenya project delivering those absolutely blistering grades out of the drill bit, existing cash flow, incredibly strong balance sheet, reserve replacement, and a clear path to 110,000 ounces of annual production. That's really exciting. Now, again, I'll reiterate, we don't have any hedges. We don't have any debt. We have cash on the balance sheet, and we have this super exciting exploration portfolio that we're investing a lot of money in, and we're getting the results that we expected and then some from that investment. Thank you very much. Sarah, open to take any questions.
Thank you very much indeed. Eric, that was populated with sound bites. No debt, dividend, district scale play, ace in the hole, dripping with gold, constellations of gold, unhedged. My good heavens. So let's deconstruct some of that, shall we? Because usually it's the product that defines a company. And according to you tonight, it's got the potential to be dripping in gold. However, you have a variable which you don't have full control over. So I'm talking about, we've got universally around the globe, we've got the rise of resource nationalism, government intervention in terms of taxes, agreements, permitting, VAT. So how are you adapting your investment strategy and exploration portfolio to mitigate exposure now and in the future to this resource nationalism, which is growing and becoming commonplace universally?
Yeah, we just had our board meeting earlier today, and there was discussion of what's happening in South America. I mean, it looks awful. You know, some of those countries, you know, what they're doing is awful. Now, the answer to this in my mind is very clear. It goes back to what the purpose is of a company. What is Shanta's purpose? The purpose of Shanta is to benefit the communities. You know, and how do we get to that answer? The answer is simple, because the question is so simple. Who would be most worse off if Shanta didn't exist? It's not me, it's not the shareholders, it's not the government, it's the communities who will be worse off. And so when you think about really your purpose, the purpose is to benefit the people who will be most worse off, because they're then going to reciprocate and benefit to you. That's how it works. I mean, it's very, you know, I've been operating in Tanzania for a long time in these places, and, you know, we've gone through some pretty dark days in Tanzania. We went through it unscathed. And it really comes back to, you have to benefit the people that will be most worse off if you don't exist. And they'll take care of you. You know, and from our perspective, you know, we've done all sorts of community projects. We pay a lot of tax. We pay local levies. You know, we're a big believer in local employment. We're now up to 99.4% of our workforce is Tanzanian. I mean, I don't think there's another gold miner that can say that. And everyone says they get to about 95%, because the last 5% is all the expats who fly in and fly out, you know, on a bi-weekly basis. Our mines are actually run by Tanzanians. And, you know, that gives you the angle into the best relationships in these countries, you know, the best understanding of procurement. You know, it's a cover, you know, the government can see that it's Tanzanians benefiting Tanzania. And so, you know, really there is a bit of a, I wouldn't call it a secret sauce, because there's no secret about it. It really just comes back to what your whole purpose is as a company.
Okay, and this is a good moment to tell people that if they don't have a Twitter account, perhaps they ought to, because there is visual evidence of the work that you're doing within the communities. I think you've built, is it a dormitory or a school for ladies?
Yeah, I was down there 3 weeks ago. It's incredible. I mean, we've been having teachers come from the UK to train the trainers, you know, for years. And then what became very clear to us was that the students don't make it to school because they have to travel so far. And so it's not safe. So what we did is we created this this dormitory for senior school girls to live and to basically live on site at the schools. It's one of many projects.
Okay, and they can all be seen on Twitter. I have to take you up on that word that you have emerged relatively unscathed. That's not really the case, is it? Because you've had to fight for VAT rebates. Some of the VAT rebates are still not forthcoming. For you and for the shareholders, that's, you know, real squeaky bottom time, surely.
Yeah, no, you can see it here on the bottom of this slide. It's $26 million of VAT receivable. What does that mean? Well, it means the government owes us $26 million that hasn't been repaid. So typically that would be about a couple million. And it's quite commonplace in a lot of countries. Now, The good news is that we're having very active discussions about this, and the government can see exactly that the funding of the refunding of VAT will go straight into a project like Singida. You know, we're going to spend $35 million there, and that needs some funding. So, you know, as I said, I was in Tanzania 3 weeks ago, had really good discussions, and there's a lot of common sense, put it that way, that may not have been there over the years, that that sees the benefit of being able to increase the tax base that the government has to invest and can't strangle. So it's we've always said it'll come back, and there's no change to that.
Okay,
and timing.
Yeah, and this is an element of your story which I think you need to be possibly reinforcing a bit more. The fact that you're now back on the ground, which is wonderful. You're in Tanzania, you're no longer locked down. The fact is that relationships are stronger and more collaborative with local and national administrations. However, Alan says, as an unhedged producer with a developing level of reserves, it extends the life, but the share price does not reflect this potential. Any idea why?
Yeah, I mean, I you know, from our perspective, it's hard to comment on the share price. All these things eventually correct themselves. That's how efficient markets will work. Eventually, there'll be some sort of event where the true value will be realized, and we've come from a very a very long way over the last 3.5-4 years. We were down at about 3p. Today we're at 13, and this West Kenya project looks incredibly exciting, and so we're confident that there's yet many more legs to go in the story.
Okay, but the way you're talking, it's as though you've got the luxury of time. But for some shareholders, they're slightly more impatient than you are. However, there is a lot of research coming out from the investment houses. I'll quote one. It says, from a risk reward perspective, we continue to see substantial upside for the gold related equities with an average 37.5% upside potential to target. I think they're referencing that the price of gold at the moment could be back on an upwards trajectory. How important is it that gold maintains a certain level?
Yeah, I mean, we obviously would like it to be as high as possible, and the fundamentals seem to be pointing in that direction. From our perspective, the best way that we can provide cover against a volatile gold price is by keeping our costs down. So by managing all the things that are in our control. The gold price isn't in our control, but it's all relative, because there are a lot of much lower grading producers who will suffer far quicker on a declining gold price. And that just spells more opportunity for us.
Particularly if you've got constellations of gold at West Kenya.
Yeah.
One of the other sound bites that you punctuated your presentation with was that you have cash in hand. How much cash in hand? And is it comfortable?
Well, the company has $24 million of cash. I think it's slightly higher today. And that gives us a lot of, it gives us the financial flexibility to be confident with investing in things like exploration, investing in West Kenya. And, we have that supported by a strong, strong set of cash flow as well. That'll fund Singida. So, that's why I say, like, the risk reward profile in Shanta isn't what it was 3 years ago, where there was far too much debt and hedging. Felt more asymmetrical to the downside. As we see it today, given the financial profile is very strong, it really comes down to what we can deliver through the drill bit, in our view.
Okay, you're very loose and languorous. I'm hoping it's because you've actually had a rest during the summer, and because we are approaching the start of the new school term, as it were. So, what could possibly go wrong then, Eric?
Well, I've actually just been, I've been traveling for 7 weeks, believe it or not. Two quarantines, in and out of Africa, London. I mean, it's literally just got, what could go wrong? Well, the gold price, first of all, is something we can't control. Shanta, as it is, obviously is a producer, and you know, there's a lot of people within the company, and production is our single most important deliverable, and so we take that very seriously. It's part of everybody's KPIs. Everybody suffers if production suffers, and so that's something that is absolutely top of mind. You know, it's serious to make sure that a producer is focused on production as the first priority and growth as a second.
Okay, two quarantines. You've been flying all over the place the last 7 weeks. Is that because you were looking at different jurisdictions? Malcolm Hopkins gets the final question, which is, are you investigating other opportunities in other jurisdictions, for example, Australia?
We're certainly not looking at Australia. You know, I mean, listen, I spent time in East Africa, in the UK. And you know, it's just after a long overdue break because of travel. So, you know, I think from the perspective of what does Shanta want to do as a strategy, it's to demonstrate the value in our portfolio. First and foremost, we think there's a lot of value that's, inherent, but not demonstrated. And, you know, we'd be, I couldn't see us doing anything unless there was a great opportunity that presented itself. We're very careful on M&A. We look at a lot of things, and we're very careful. So nothing at the moment.